You'll have a seat on the stand. Just that microphone.
John Marvin Murdaugh, Murdaugh.
Mr. Murdaugh, will you tell the jury just briefly some background information? Where are you from? What do you do?
Yes, sir. So I was born in Columbia, grew up in Hampton, attended public schools from first grade through high school, graduated Wade Hampton, went to the University of South Carolina, got a degree in criminal justice, and I'm now self-employed. I've opened some companies in the heavy equipment business.
What's the name of your company?
Well, the main company is Murdaugh Rental Center, but I've got Murdaugh Kubota, Murdaugh Equipment, LLC. So generally speaking, I'm in the construction equipment, agricultural tractors and implements. I'm in the equipment business.
And do you have offices, locations, multiple locations?
I have two, one in Hampton and one in Okotie, Bluffton area.
Are you related to the defendant, Richard Alexander Murdaugh?
I am. I'm his brother.
Do you have any other brothers?
I do. Randy Murdaugh is my brother.
And do you have a sister?
I do. Lynn.
All right.
Both are here.
And your parents are whom?
Randolph and Libby Murdaugh. Okay.
Are you the only son of the three that didn't go to law school?
I am, and I'm quite proud of it.
tell the jury generally about the Murdaugh family, your family in this area.
Well, I mean, obviously, we're probably like most families or a lot of families. We're very close. I mean, the siblings, we stay in touch. We do holidays together. We, you know, you try to interact and keep your family core together. I mean, we're just, you know, a normal family doing normal family things.
Right. Do your parents, and we've heard about your father, Randolph Murdaugh, who died on June the 10th, is that correct?
That's correct.
And then your mother is Miss Libby?
She is.
And she's still alive, correct?
She is. In fact, yesterday was her birthday.
And you went by to see her, I understand.
I did, with my kids.
In the spring of 2021, were they both alive? Was your dad alive?
Yes, sir.
And what was his health in the spring of 2021?
Well, for some, he had been battling cancer, and not just cancer. I'll use that term loosely. He had multiple forms of cancer. But he had been battling cancer, had health issues. He had been through heart surgeries. Just overall, his health was not good. Just in and out of hospitals, just
right.
Age and the diseases were catching up to him.
And would you check in on your mom and dad any chance you've got?
I would. So I didn't tell y'all this, but so I don't live in Hampton. I live, my wife and family and I, we live down in Beaufort, or just outside of Beaufort. And so my drive is about an hour's drive to do it. So I didn't visit as often as Randy and Alec because they were in Hampton. But absolutely, anytime I had the opportunity to work in Hampton at my office, I would always take time to stop by. And then sometimes I would just wanted to go see my mom.
Was it routine for one, so either your brothers who lived in Hampton to stop by and check on them routinely?
Oh, absolutely. I don't know every time they went because I wasn't there, but I feel confident that they visited more just because of the proximity. It's just an easier visit.
So, well, let's talk about proximity. Your brother Randy, where does he live?
He lives in Hampton, in town.
And then your sister, Lynn, where does she live?
She lives in Somerville.
Okay. And then Alec, where did he live in the spring of 2021?
Well, I think in the spring of 21, he was living in Moselle. I think all of them were.
Okay. And is Moselle close to Almeda?
Well, it's further than Randy's house, but much closer than mine.
Right. And is that, and your mother's house, I'm saying Almeda, but is Almeda a town? Or
what? No, Almeda's correct. That's the location. That's the property name, if you will, the intersection name. I think that's a general.
And just tell the jury where that's located.
It would be east of Varnville, maybe 2 or 3 miles outside of the town limits.
Is it basically at the intersection of, I don't know, what's that mean?
Intersection of 278 and Highway 68 that would go to, one goes to Ridgeland and one goes to Yemisee.
Okay. And would Alec visit your mom and dad frequently in the spring of 2021, to your knowledge?
Oh, absolutely.
And we'll get to more of that. How well, I want to talk about Paul. How well did you know Paul?
I knew Paul very well. Excuse me, I'm going to have a hard time talking about Paul because we had a very special relationship. But I knew him very well. And I'll do my best to answer any questions about him.
Well, did he have a nickname?
he did. They called him Little Rooster.
And did they call him anything else?
Well, I mean, he'd been called Little Rooster, had been called, as you heard, Paw-Paw. I mean, that's what my family, my kids called him.
What did you call him?
Well, it depends on where we were and what we were doing. When we were doing something fun in a social event, I would refer to him as Paw-Paw. Now, y'all haven't heard this yet, but he worked for me. So when he worked for me, it was Paul, or it was Paul Terry, because I was trying to be, you know, a little more authoritative.
Right. Who else called him Paw-Paw?
Most of all the family. And that's not, you know, that's not a name that was said at all times, but when we're having fun, kids would say it. My wife would say it. It was just a name that was used in fun times and in normal times.
And you mentioned Paul worked for you. When did he work for you?
You know, that's I thought you were going to ask that, and unfortunately, I don't know. He's worked for me maybe prior to June of 21. He was working, or he was working then. I think he worked the 2 summers prior to that. And it was just summer work. I mean, it would only last a month or so, a month and a half.
And was he working for you in June of 2021?
He was.
And what was he doing for you?
Anything I asked him to do.
Where was he working?
He was working at my Bluffton Okatee store. He would do anything from power wash equipment or deliver new tractors that were being sold. Talk to customers, help customers load and unload rental equipment. As you heard someone testify, that boy would work. And so whatever was asked of him, he would do.
Was he on the phone the whole time, or did he actually work?
Not at work, he was not. Well, not while I was there.
Oh, right. Was he a good worker?
He was an excellent worker.
Did you spend time with Paul? Let me back up. Do you have a place where you hunt? You have a property?
I do.
Do you have a name for that property?
We call it Greenfield.
And would Paul and Buster come out to Greenfield to hunt?
They would. Absolutely.
Let me just back up. What was the relationship between Alec, Paul, and Buster?
Oh, it was a great relationship. You know, anything that the boys were doing, Alec wanted to do, and the boys always came first to him. Some of y'all may have been on dove hunts before, but I have a very small field, and you know, I've got 10 stands in the field, and I have, before the hunt, I have it organized where I know who's sitting where. Well, I have Alec. He says, well, can the boys come? Well, of course they can come. So now I've got to rearrange for that. Or if they said they were coming and the boys backed out, Alec always backed out. I, I was thinking about this. To this day, I don't believe he has ever come hunting with me since his boys have been old enough to hunt without his boys. It's always with the boys.
Did he do other things with them?
Yeah, did sporting events, you know, football games, baseball games.
Was he close with his sons?
Very close.
Right. And how about Maggie? What did you observe of his relationship with Maggie?
It was a great relationship. I mean, all marriages, I'm sure, have hiccups here and there, but I'm telling you, it was a good marriage. In coming here, I was trying to think of ways to describe it. My wife and I and Ellick and Maggie, we went to a concert together. It was the Darius Rucker concert. And of course, we're sitting in there. Ellick and Maggie are sitting just below us. And I had just gone, and I hope I can say this in court, I had just gone and bought one of those $15 beers, and I was back in my seat, and song's playing, and my wife taps me, and Ellick and Maggie are holding hands and swaying together, and she's like, why aren't you holding my hand? And so my $15 beer got put down. They had a great relationship. I mean, that's just one of many. Football games, they would put out a tailgate spread, they would welcome the kids, family, friends. It was just a wonderful.
And did they do a lot of family things together with Paul and Buster and Paul and Buster's friends?
Yes, they did. You know, I knew of trips that they would take, family trips, you know, vacations. They had a house at Edisto that y'all have heard about, and they would have, you know, they would always have friends come over, particularly the boys' friends.
There's been some discussion during this case about Paul leaving guns and stuff around. Did you ever experience that?
I did.
And tell the jury a little bit about your experience.
Well, you know, I've heard the testimony about it, and it's accurate. I mean, I could tell you all 100 stories of him leaving things, but he was notorious. He would come stay with us at our house. He would leave. Liz would have all of his clothes washed, and, you know, he just left and didn't care about where his clothes were. In fact, Paul came duck hunting with me one time and at Greenfield, and I smile fondly on this when I, you know, think back on all this. So we had a great duck hunt. I think there were three of us in the blind. Great duck hunt. We picked up all the birds, decoys, and we left, and we go back up and have a nice breakfast. You're doing all the post hunt, all the fun things that you do. Well, I went back hunting. I don't know, it was probably a week and a half, maybe 2 weeks later, and his hunting gear is still in the blind. I mean, I had to smile when I saw it. I was like, that's Paul.
Right. Did I want to ask you a little bit about riding property. I mean, you ride your property down at Greenfield?
I do.
And have you
riding in what?
Like checking on the property.
Oh, you mean like just riding around, joyriding or checking feeders or?
Right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And do you always carry a gun when you're doing that?
I don't.
And have you ridden property like at your dad's place with your dad and maybe Alec or others? I mean, is that
right.
Frequent occurrence?
I would say almost never when I rode the property with my dad.
Almost never carry a gun?
Almost never would we carry a gun. We would just joyride. Right now, if it were late in the afternoon and we were considering maybe getting in a deer stand, you know, at the last minute possibly. But typically with my dad and us, we didn't carry a gun then.
Right. Speaking of your dad, what was, you recall what was going on with his health the weekend, the Saturday, Sunday, before June the 7th, so I guess we'd start, Friday would be the 4th, Saturday would be the 5th, Sunday would be the 6th.
Right. So he was actually in the hospital, I believe in Columbia, that weekend. And I think he got out of the hospital on Sunday.
Okay, and Did you pick him up? Your brother picked him up? You know who picked
him
up?
I did not. I didn't. I may have been out of town. I can't recall. I've heard the testimony about it. I did not pick him up.
Did you end up taking your father to the doctor on that Monday, June the 7th?
I did.
And where did you take him?
I took him to Savannah.
And
to his, what I would call his normal doctor. I think Columbia was maybe he had to go up there for some different things or another. I'm not sure.
And was he having some breathing issues on?
He was having major breathing issues.
And when you went to the doctor on Monday, June the 7th, was there a decision made to admit him to the hospital?
It was. So when I took him, we were only going to a doctor's appointment. We were not going to the hospital. It was just me taking him to a doctor's appointment to try to find out what the breathing issues were, maybe some type of a treatment or medication or something to help him. While we were there, not as soon as the doctor saw him, but when the doctor saw him and went through some things, he immediately told both of us that he had to be in the hospital, that he was not getting the oxygen that he needed.
When was he admitted on that Monday?
He was.
And what was, as you understood, the prognosis when he was put back in the hospital on Monday the 8th, I mean the 7th?
On Monday the 7th, yes. So my understanding was the doctor that we were seeing or that he was seeing had some really strong beliefs that the cancer that he had was not causing the breathing obstructions, that it very likely could be pneumonia. And he told us, he said, if it's the cancer, that's the worst, but if it's pneumonia like I think it is, I think we've got some treatment options.
So what was there hope on June the 7th?
Absolutely. When he told me that, first of all, when he said he had to go into hospital, it scared me. Obviously it scares you when a doctor tells you immediately have to check in. But yes, him explaining that he was optimistic that it was going to be pneumonia and that there would be a breathing treatment to help it, I felt pretty good.
Now, in evidence, and I'm not going to read it again, but did you and your brother send out text messages to family members giving them an update?
We did.
And that was on the 7th?
That was on the 7th.
And in the update, did you explain the doctor believed it was pneumonia?
Yes, I gave a basic summary of what I was told by the doctor, what I believed it to be. I think Randy and I had a few minutes to talk, and he typed up another email just to make sure that everybody was in the loop.
Okay.
A text message.
Text message.
I'm sorry.
Okay. And did the diagnosis and the prognosis subsequently change on
Well,
your death?
It did. It did.
When was that?
Well, so on Tuesday afternoon, we're back out at Alameda. We're back at Moselle, and we still hadn't heard much. All this other stuff going on. It's so much going on. Randy called me and told me they had done everything that they could do, and that he would be coming home in an ambulance under hospice care.
Okay. And did he die on June the 10th?
He died, I think, 2 days later.
Take your time.
That's all right. That's all right.
Going back to taking your dad to the doctor and then checking in the hospital, there's some vehicles being switched around a little bit, and we'll get to that. But can you explain to the jury how all that transportation went to get to your dad to the hospital? Well, doctor,
you're talking about on that Monday for me
yeah,
to get
yes,
him.
On, yeah. yeah, on June, yeah, so June the 7th.
it's a little bit complicated, but I'll do my best to explain it. So Randy, on Monday morning, Dad had been in the hospital Sunday, got out Sunday, knew that he needed to be seen by his regular doctor, but did not have an appointment. And so Randy was doing everything he could to get him in as early as he could on that Monday, and just asked me, he says, if I get the appointment, can you take him? And I said, absolutely, I'd be delighted to. A little while later, an hour or two, I don't know, it was still that morning, Randy calls me and says, okay, they have an opening for him, but he has to get there right away. So Hampton is, what, an hour and a half from Savannah, hour and a half. He said, you don't have time to drive to Hampton to get him. I will meet you in Ridgeland about halfway, which is not far from my house. And then you just take him and I'll go back. He had some time-sensitive things to work on. So we met at Palmetto Co-op in Ridgeland. I got in my mom's car with my dad. Randy got in my truck and drove it back to Alameda where Randy had come to pick up my dad. So Randy's truck's back at mom and dad's house. So I drive dad to Savannah in my mom's car, go through what we just talked about, the doctor's appointment, getting checked in. And back then COVID was still going on and there were several restrictions. They wouldn't let me go back with my dad at that time. So I was gonna be driving home and now I'm stuck in my mom's car. So I know Paul was working and it was around five or so and that's when we close. I called Paul and said, Paul, listen, I need you to, if you would, drive my mom's car back to Alameda, pick up my truck and bring it to work the next morning. And then just leave your, he was driving a like a farm truck that day. I said, leave it and I'll drive it and we'll just swap back the next morning. And so that's how our cars got swapped.
All right, so when you got back on the evening of the 7th, did you see Paul?
I did.
And where did you see him?
At my house.
And he got into your mom's
car
and drove, right. to
and drove it to Alameda and then got in my truck and drove it to Moselle.
Okay. And you said the farm truck was at your house. Do you remember where Paul's truck was?
Paul's normal truck was in the shop being worked on.
Was that Jimmy Butler's?
It was a shop in Varnville, Jimmy Butler's, yes, okay. Sir.
Now, when you last saw Paul, was he just as normal as you see him every day?
Oh, absolutely. He was playing with my kids in the yard, waiting on me to get there. In fact, that particular day, he was pretty dirty. So whatever he had been doing back at work had him pretty dirty, but he was playing with the kids in the yard, being Paul.
Is that the last time you saw him?
That is the last time I saw him.
When did you learn that, and how did you learn that Maggie and Paul were murdered on the night of June the 7th?
Well, I Alec called me, and Liz and I, we have three young kids, younger kids. I mean, our youngest is 8 now, so it would have been 6 at the time, and so we don't have a lot of free time to ourselves, but that night we were watching television,
Well, let me back up. Had Alec called you earlier in the night when he was on his way to his mom's?
Yes, sir.
And that we got phone records of that. What do you recall of that conversation?
He called, just checking on me. Just said, I saw the news about Dad. Things look good, It was a brief conversation, and I hate to say it, but I've kind of said, listen, I finally have a few minutes. Can we talk tomorrow? We're watching a movie.
And what was his demeanor when you spoke with him on the evening of the 7th?
Same as always, just normal.
And then later on that night, you got another phone call from him?
And I got when you asked the question, how did I learn? Yes, Alec called me and just absolutely hysterical. As soon as I heard his voice, I knew something bad was going on, didn't know what. I'm in my pajamas. He said, something bad has really happened. And I don't know what his exact words, but I think he said, Maggie and Paul have been hurt really badly. Please get here as fast as you can. And, you know, I drop what I'm doing and I go get dressed and I'm hurrying. I'm, you know, just so many things are going through your mind. You don't know what to do. So I get dressed and I run outside and realize I don't have a car. I've Paul's car is out there and it is a hunk of junk. And I mean, you know,
this was the farm truck.
This was a farm truck. And so I knew I couldn't take my wife's car because she was taking the kids to school. And I knew something bad. I just didn't know how bad it was.
And so did you then get in the farm truck and head to Moselle?
I did.
And what happened along the way?
Well, so along the way, I'd spoken to Randy. He asked me to try to get in touch with a close family friend and one of their law partners, Danny Henderson. I was just constantly trying to call him. I'm driving fast. I'm trying to get to Moselle. And, you know, once I got Danny and told him that he needed to get up there, you know, I had a few minutes to myself, and I was crying. And somebody called me shortly after that. I don't know who it was. I can't remember. But I remember it was either Alec or Randy, I believe. And they said the sheets were being pulled over them.
Did the farm truck break down?
It did.
How'd you end up getting to Moselle?
Well, so let me back up and tell you. So the route that from my house down in Okotie, Beaufort, takes me to Coosahatchee, and I get on 95 to go to Yemisi and getting off and coming up that way. Well, another close family friend, his name is Greg Alexander. He is the chief of police in Yemisi. I reach out to him, and I just say, Greg, I gave him said something bad had happened. Or again, I don't know when I was told about the sheets, but I told him, I said, listen, something bad's happened. We got to get up there. When I get to Yemisi, can you please help make sure I get to Moselle? Because this truck's sputtering, and I knew it wasn't good. And he met me at Yemisi, and he fell in behind me, and we started driving until he finally passed me in Varnville. Well, go ahead.
And did he end up driving you the rest of the way?
Well, he did. So he passed me shortly before Varnville. He took a ride on 63, and he was a little ways ahead of me when the truck quit on me. I called him and said, Greg, I said, come back and get me. The truck has broken down. And, of course, he picked me up and took me straight on to Moselle.
Were there any guns in the farm truck that Paul had left when you got in it?
I have no idea. It was dark when I got in it. I, as y'all can imagine, I was frantic. I jumped in it and I took off.
Did you ever see any guns in it?
That night, never. I mean, I didn't look. I mean, it just, right. I wasn't looking in the back seat. I wasn't worried about anything except getting to Moselle.
Okay. Do you remember about the time you got to Moselle? What time was it, roughly? Or better yet, who was there when you got there?
Well, before I got to Moselle, or we got to Moselle, you could see the lights flashing. It was just, there were tons of people. It mostly what I would describe is first responders of some sort.
And when you pulled up, where did you go?
So we came in the main gate and came around, and it created a small crime scene. And when we pulled up, I saw Alec, and I think before Greg even stopped the car, I jumped out and ran to him.
And what was his condition, Alec's?
Oh, he was just broken. I mean, distraught. I mean, everybody was. There were a few other people there, but he just, all we did is hugged and cried. I mean, I don't even know that we talked.
How long did you stay down adjacent to the crime scene, do you recall?
Quite some time. I have to assume that I probably was there at the 11 o'clock-ish. I don't know what time I got there, but I don't think we went back up to the house, until well after midnight, maybe 2, 3.
And when you went to the house, you recall if any sled agents came up there?
Well, I did not see any. I heard some testimony, some came and got some clothes, but I did not see any sled agents at the house. The last officer that I remember seeing that night, or officers, were the ones that told us that we needed to leave that area, that they were going to be doing stuff with the bodies, and that we needed to go to the house.
Right. When you went into the house, were there other people in there when you got in?
There were. You know, most people that I knew, some of Alec's partners, Randy's partners, family members, Lynn.
Was there food out or had food? What was it? Had anything?
I didn't see any food, but I saw pots and pans, and I saw folks that were cleaning up. They were removing pots and pans, but, you know, I never opened it and looked in it, so I presumed that it was food. They cleaned dishes. They put the pots and pans away or in the refrigerator.
Was a TV on in the house? Do you remember?
Based on what I know, I would say it is, but I can't tell you 100% that it was on, but I'd be willing to bet it was.
What do you mean when you say based on what you know?
I don't think I'd ever been in that house without the TV being on if Alec and Maggie were there.
After, did you ultimately go to Almeda that evening with Alec, Buster, and his girlfriend, Brooklyn?
We did.
Do you remember what Alec was wearing when he went to Almeda?
Not precise. I can't, he was wearing shorts and a T-shirt. I can't tell you details, but it was shorts and a T-shirt, you know, like relaxed shorts.
Do you know whether he had had a shower or not?
It appeared he had. Okay. I mean, his hair was not. I didn't see him in the shower, but I can tell you I think he had a shower.
I understand. So then let's move forward to the morning of the June 8th. I guess, did you get any sleep the night of June the 7th?
Very little. I don't know that I fell asleep. I've certainly laid in the bed. It's just, as you can imagine, just the thoughts and things. I don't know if I slept. When I got up and started moving the next day, I certainly didn't feel like I'd slept.
What did you do the next day when you got up?
You talking about precisely or generally?
Just generally.
I got up and Alec was up. I don't think Buster and Buckman were. I told Alec that I was going over to Greenfield. My farm that I told you all about is 2 or 3 miles away, so it's very close. And I have all, you know, plenty of clothes over there. So I told him I was going over there to shower and put on fresh clothes and that I would meet him at Moselle.
And did you go to Moselle?
I did, after I left Greenfield. Yes, sir.
And do you remember who was there when you got to Moselle?
I was the first one there.
And what did you do?
I just went to stay there until I knew Buster, Brooklyn, and Alec were coming. I suspected that other family members and partners, I knew others were coming, so I just kind of sat there in disbelief still. It's just, you know, moments of just.
Was the door to the house unlocked? Do you remember?
You know, that's a good question. I thought about it. I don't remember. It either was unlocked or I had the code, because there's a keypad on a side door, but I can't tell you which door I went in. I don't know.
Did you eventually go down to the kennels?
I did. Once everyone got there, there was, you know, a fair amount of activity in the house with family and law partners, Alec's law partners, Randy's law partners. I just felt like I needed to go down. I needed to see for myself what had gone on and just kind of take it in. I mean, just maybe for some type of understanding.
How long did you stay down there at the kennels?
Well, I don't know. But I will say this, before I went, I was unsure whether I was allowed to go because I knew it was a crime scene. And so I reached out to a friend of mine in law enforcement and said, listen, I don't know who's handling the crime scene. I don't know whatever. He said, well, I'll find out and make sure that it's clear for you to go. And he said, don't go until I tell you. And he called me back a few minutes later and said he had spoken to, I believe it was Captain Ryan Neal, and had given the okay that everything was released and it was okay to go there.
And was it cleaned up?
No, Jim, it was not cleaned up.
Okay. Were there skull fragments?
Yeah, so, excuse me, this is going to be really difficult. So I could easily see where Maggie had been. You know, I saw the night before where the sheets were, and somebody had told me that who was who. And so I could see where Maggie had been, and it was grass, and, you know, they had covered it up with dirt. So there really was nothing to see where Maggie was. I walked over to the feed room, and y'all have heard the descriptions. Y'all saw it. I've never seen pictures, and I've told them before coming to this court that I was not going to see pictures. But y'all can imagine what I experienced. It had not been cleaned up. I saw blood. I saw brains. I saw pieces of skull. And when I say brains, it could just be tissue. I don't know what I was seeing. It was terrible. And for some reason, I thought it was my something that I needed to do for Paul. To clean it up. I felt like it was the right thing to do. I felt like I owed him, and I started cleaning. And I can promise you, no mother or father or aunt or uncle should ever have to see and do what I did that day. I don't know, I'm not blaming anybody, but it's just, I was just overwhelmed. I did everything I could, and I would have moments where I would stop crying for a moment, and just in disbelief. At one point, I called my brother Randy, and told him what I was doing, trying to describe what I was doing, and he immediately told me to stop doing it. It was not good for me. It was not healthy for me to be there, and. I couldn't stop. I had to do it for Paul. That's just what I had to do. And I don't know, it's probably 15, 20 minutes later, Mark Paul shows up. Y'all heard Mark Paul testify. And he came and hugged me and told me it was okay to leave. Okay to leave what was left of Paul, that they would clean it up. The hardest thing I've ever been through in my life.
Yes, sir. What'd you do next?
Mark basically got me. I'm sure I was just a basket case, but he got me back to the house and, you know, got me back around family and, you know, just got back to, you know, the support of others that were there. And you know, there were a lot of people at the house at that point.
Do you remember when you got back to the house, at some point in time, people raising questions or bringing up the fact that Maggie's phone had not been located?
Yeah, so that were, you know, particular the lawyers, they were all, you know, being lawyers, they were, you know, questioning things amongst themselves and, you know, how could this happen, trying to figure things out. But it was brought to my attention that Maggie's phone was not there and that law enforcement had not found it. And I can't say that, in fact, I can probably say that I didn't think of it because I'm not a big phone user or a big app user or whatnot, but somebody brought to my attention and says, listen, if Buster or Alec, if they have an app on their phone, like find my phone or find my friends or an app like that, they said you very likely can find out where the phone is if the battery's not dead. And so I went to Buster, and sure enough, I said, Buster, do you have this one of these apps like they're talking about? And he said, yeah, sure I do. I said, well, open it up. He opened it up, and he handed me the phone, and I see Maggie's name, and I press it where, you know, to activate it, and it pings Maggie's phone just out front of the property. And I was like, I hate to say it, but I said, holy shit, there it is. And I said, Buster, I'm taking your phone. I'm going to go back down to the shed and show it to law enforcement.
And who did you approach first about the phone?
Well, I don't know who it was. Presumably it was SLED agents, because keep in mind, I didn't know any of these guys with SLED. I mean, there were a couple of faces that I'd seen before, but I don't know these guys. I've come to know them, but I don't know them or didn't know them then. So I went up to a SLED agent or two SLED agents and said, presumably SLED agents, and said, hey, I've got Buster's phone here, and it's got an app on it that can find the phone, and it's showing Maggie's phone's right out here. Let's go get it. And he said, no need. We have technology coming later today that we should be able to find it. And it blew me away that I'm sitting here showing them where Maggie's phone is, but they won't take the time to walk with me or take this phone itself. I mean, I'd give them the phone to go find it. So I walk over. I knew Duffy Stone. He was the solicitor. I knew one of his investigators. I walked over to them, said the exact same thing, and they immediately said, absolutely, let's go find this thing before the battery goes dead.
And what happened?
That we did that. We started walking down the back entrance, or the kennel entrance, if you will. And as we were, and at that time, the agent was holding the phone. You know, I'm looking at it with him. And when it pings, it creates a dot or a location. And that dot jumped from right at the end of that road down the road, I don't know, maybe a half a mile, three quarters of a mile. And so we walked back, got into a car, and drove down to where it was showing the phone.
And was the phone?
And I rode with those agents, the solicitor's office agents.
Was the phone ultimately located on the side of the road?
Absolutely, we found it in a matter of minutes.
Okay. Do you remember how it was collected? I mean, were you present when it was collected?
I was. So I was on. There's a cow pasture on one side, and it's wooded on the other side. And I was on the side that the cow pasture's on, if you will. And I heard him say, I got it. And so, you know, of course, I walked back beside his car, and I'm good ways from it, but I see him over there. And I think he took either some ribbon or some flagging or flagging tape and marked the phone. And I don't think he touched it. I think he left it right where it was. Called SLED, and maybe at that time, maybe they had been communicating, but SLED had blocked off the road at this point, and one of the agents came up and picked the phone up. Okay. And I don't know which agent. Again, I didn't know him.
Did any law enforcement officer ask you if you knew the password?
Yes. So once they and I'll say this. So they did take pictures of it while it was on the ground before they touched it. They picked it up. I think they had gloves on. They picked it up, brought it back to the trunk of the car, and opened it up in power zone. And they then asked, you know, what's the password? And of course, I didn't know it.
Did you find out the password?
I did. I called Alec, and he gave me the password. I repeated it to the agent. They put the password in and said, it's open.
So Alec provided you the password that you passed to the agents, and it opened the phone? Is that
yes,
correct?
Sir. That's correct.
John Marvin, were you aware of a news release that was issued that morning, Tuesday, June 8th, that the public had no need to be alarmed or concerned for their safety?
Yes, sir.
Well, what was your reaction to that?
I mean, it's quite baffling. It still is. two people have been killed, and they're telling me that everybody's safe. That tells me that whoever's done this is in jail, and they are 100% positive. Because if they're not in jail, nobody's safe.
Right. Did you go back to the residence at Moselle after finding the phone? Did you go back up to the house?
Yes, sir, I did.
And did SLED agents come through and search it while you were present?
They did. I don't know how long I'd been back up there, but they came and we kind of talked in the playroom, or I think some have described it as the gun room. Yeah, they talked about that they needed to come in the house and search for things.
And did you escort, I think it was Agent McAllister, throughout the house?
Yes, it was Katie McAllister.
And did she tell you what she was looking for?
Initially, she says, well, the way she presented it was, you know, there were so many people in the house. She said, listen, I don't want to just go barging in and make everybody run out of the house, but I'm going to take my badge off, my gun off, and if you would, just walk me through each room. And, you know, particularly I'm looking for 12-gauge shotgun guns and 300 blackout and the ammunition for those calibers.
And as you're walking through the house with her, it appeared she was looking for other things besides just guns.
Well, yeah, I mean, you could tell she's looking, because she looked in spaces that guns wouldn't fit, so it makes sense that she could be looking for something else.
Such as what?
Well, I don't know.
I understand, but you said spaces. Did she look in the bathrooms?
I opened up up in the upstairs area, there's some cabinets that, you know, a couple of them are pretty small that, you know, she could find ammunition in there, but I don't know how you would get a gun in there.
Did she search bathrooms?
She did. Well, I took her through every room in the house.
Right.
I mean, every single room.
Did you observe her looking in sinks and toilets?
Yes, sir. What I observed is, like, the shower, for example, it's a door. It's not an open shower. She opened the door, and she looked around, and, you know, she was looking at it. She easily would have known there was no gun in it when she opened it, but it was obvious that she was looking a little deeper.
Right. What kind of guns were there at Moselle?
Well, it sounds like the guns of all kinds, you know, rifles, shotguns. I've seen bow and arrows. I've seen crossbows. Most anything that you would hunt with.
Right. And were guns mostly in the gun room, to your knowledge, when you were over there?
Well, when I went through the house, we identified, I remember one gun in particular that was in the bedroom, a shotgun. I picked it up and said, you need to take this one, and we looked at it, and it was a 20-gauge. She said, no, put that one back. So I put it back. So predominantly all the guns were in the gun room or playroom.
Right. I sort of an aside, briefly, do you hunt with Alec over the years?
I have.
And did he have a go-to gun, to your knowledge, that he would use?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. When's the last time you ever seen him hunt with a 12-gauge?
You know, I'd say that when he bird hunt, he's either shooting a 20-gauge or a 28. There was a time, and please don't ask me when, but I would say it was a few years prior to this that we were turkey hunting on another piece of property down on the Savannah River. And I know he was hunting with a 12-gauge then, but I don't know whether it was his gun or somebody else's.
Did that gun have a sticker on it, do you remember?
It did. And
you remember what the sticker said?
No, I don't remember what the sticker said, but I do remember teasing Alec that when you're turkey hunting, you don't want to be seen, and, you know, big sticker on the side of your barrel is kind of like waving a white flag to a turkey.
Did did you serve as somewhat of a liaison or the point person with SLED and the family initially?
I don't know that I'd call it a liaison or a point person, but I absolutely I had become to know Agent David Owens, and I absolutely told David, I said, listen, if you need anything from me or anybody and you can't get in touch with them, you reach out to me. I will either see to it that they call you back, I will see to it that you get the answers that you're looking for, or I will put you in touch with the person you're trying to reach. So I did make myself available.
And did Alec give, to your knowledge, carte blanche to law enforcement to search anywhere that they wished?
Oh, he did. In fact, before I was going to just do something, you know, I knew that to be the case, but yes, he confirmed it with me. Anything they needed, anytime they needed it.
And you provided consent to search the house the afternoon on the 8th on his behalf, did you not?
I did. Okay. And I've consented every time they've ever asked.
We'll get to that. Were you ever asked to provide consent or see if you could obtain consent for any law enforcement to search your mom's house where Alec had been the night before?
Say that to me one more time.
Did any law enforcement ask you to consent or obtain consent so that law enforcement could search Almeda, and I'm talking about on the 8th, because Alec had just been there the night before? Did anybody ask you, hey, can we go search Almeda?
No one asked anything.
Okay. Would, if asked, would you have obtained consent for law enforcement?
I would have given them consent, and I would have taken them over there just like I did at Alec's house, and I would have helped facilitate the search to show them areas that they may not know about.
Did you remember law enforcement SLED agents coming to your Greenfield property on June the 10th?
Yes, sir, I do.
And what was that about?
I assume they coordinated it with Alec or Randy. I'm not sure who they coordinated it with, but yes, my understanding is they were coming to interview me, Randy, Alec, Buster. I think that's it. But they wanted to do interviews with all of us.
Okay. And did everyone congregate there at Greenfield?
Yes, sir. We were at Greenfield. Of course, you know, that's where we're staying there because of all this, and so it keeps me close to Hampton. So, but yes, we all congregated there.
And when the agents arrived, did they come inside and sit down and talk with each other, of you, or how did that work?
No, sir. I offered them to come inside. It was, as you can imagine, it was hot. I said come in and, you know, offered them a drink of water, whatever, just being polite. And they said, no, you know, we would like to go ahead and start our interviews.
And where did the interviews take place?
In their cars.
And were they all done simultaneously?
Yes, sir.
And how many SLED agent cars were out there? Do you remember?
Well, there was one for each person they were interviewing, and I would go ahead and guess that there were probably two or three more.
Okay. And I'm not sure that we need to actually play this, but have you been in the courtroom and you've heard this audio tape of Alec being interviewed on that June the 10th, where he states something, either I did him so bad or they did him so bad? Have you heard that?
I have.
And you know Alec's voice?
I know his voice very well.
And what is he saying on that tape?
Crystal clear, they did him so bad.
I mean, had you heard him say that before his interview that day?
You know, I think I heard him say it either the night of or the day after, but I've also heard him say it many times after.
Well before this trial started or anything?
Well before any of this, that's right. When he was staying and living with us, or between my brother and us.
After Maggie and Paul were murdered on that night of June 7th, were you or other family members with Alec for the most part, you know, for the that week and the week after that?
You talking about the days following?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I was. I made a conscious effort to be with him. I mean, as devastating as it was for me, it was 1,000 times worse for him. So I knew as a brother I needed to be there for him. And I was. Of course, I didn't sleep with him, but right. But when we were awake, I may not be standing beside him, but we would be in the room together. If we needed to go to the gas station, if he wanted dip, I'd ride with him. I just thought that's what I needed to do.
What was his demeanor that was in the immediate aftermath of these murders?
Oh, Jimmy. That night or days or
that night, the next day, the day after,
like I just said, he is when you can use words that he was destroyed. I heard somebody say he was broken. You can use any words you want to use to describe, but I can promise you words don't do it justice. I would have to create a new word to describe how distraught he was. It's terrible.
And then carry it forward all through the summer. Did he? How was he coping afterwards? Say, later June and July, and going forward.
You know, it's hard to tell. I thought he was doing okay. Other times, it would just be just sheer grief. I mean, just uncontrollably crying and just, of course it makes me cry. As y'all can tell, I'm a pretty emotional guy, but we would cry together. And there's no answers. And there's nothing I could say to make it better other than just hugging.
Did you start losing weight?
Oh, yes, sir. Absolutely.
Was he eating?
Well,
sleeping?
He was pretty heavy going into this.
Right.
And he lost a good bit of weight. I don't know how many pounds, but it became very obvious in a fairly short period of time he lost weight.
Right. I skipped over something in my outline, and I apologize. But going back on the evening of June 7th, the early morning hours, Did folks who were there at Almeda raise questions about perhaps the murder? Maggie and Paul were somehow associated with the
boat? You mean the Moselle?
Yeah, the Moselle. Going back to on the evening of June 7th and June 8th, did folks at Moselle raise issues or associate the potential motive for the murder to be related to the boating accident in some form?
Well, I heard it numerous times that night. I heard it at Moselle, and I actually heard it by, Greg, Chief Alexander mentioned it. Once I got over the chaotic part of describing what we were doing, why I needed to get to Moselle, he asked me he's driving in front of me, and he asked me, do you think it's related to the boat accident? And of course, Greg, I don't know. I don't know anything about what's happened.
Were you aware of the boating accident and Paul's charges?
Yes, sir.
Weren't you aware? And was there a backlash in the community over that?
Well, it was. It was a lot of backlash. I would not say quite as much in the community, but as on social media and media inflamed rumors is what the way I would describe it.
Right.
That it was just totally blown out of proportion, and I don't want to downplay the accident, but what they were saying about the stuff about Paul and Alec, it was just totally inflamed.
Okay.
And you asked about the boating accident, so I told y'all that I called Michael Paul, my friend, to make sure I could go to the crime scene the next morning. Well, Michael Paul is one of my best friends, if not my best friend. I called him that night while we were still down at the crime scene, not because he's in law enforcement, not because of anything, because he's my friend. And I actually told him on the phone. I said, MP is what I called. I said, MP, I don't even know why I called you. I just needed to talk to somebody. And we talked and, you know, cried a little bit after I described. He didn't know what had happened, so I told him, and, you know, I cried, and he, you could tell he was upset. But in that conversation, he asked me also, do you think it could be related to the boating accident?
Objection.
Switching gears a little bit, John Marvin, when talk to you about visiting at your mom's house, mom and dad's house. Let's talk. Where do you routinely park, or where do you park sometimes when going over to your mom and dad's house?
Me, you're asking where I park?
You and others, you know, in the family.
Well, it's a couple of places you can park, depending on who's there, whether there's other cars there. You know, you can either park at the what you call a carport, and there's a big dirt area beside it. You could park there, walk up to the side door, or you can pull around to the back corner, park there. Okay. You know, we all use both spots.
I'm going to pull up and look at it on your screen.
As a matter of fact, I told you it's my mom's birthday. I went there yesterday. I pulled right into the back of the house, but I didn't turn around. I circled the house. Okay. So there's.
So I'm going to pull up State's Exhibit 524. It's in evidence, Doug, and go to slide 38. And this is the GPS OnStar data. And Doug, if you'll blow up around the house, please, sir. Thank you. Mr. Murdoch, this is your mom's house, and this is GPS data from the night of June the 7th. Do you see that the red line there?
Yeah, it's pretty blurry on my screen. I don't know about y'all's.
Well, you want to back it out a little bit, Doug? All right. Just... Is that better?
Well, yes, it's still blurry, but I can see.
Where is that in relation to your mom's house?
You're talking about the right there where the arrow's pointing?
Yes, sir.
That is at the back corner of the house.
Okay.
That would be exactly where I parked yesterday.
Sorry. And if you'll pull up, Doug, Exhibit 136. And this would be Defendant's Exhibit 136 in evidence. And tell me where that is.
That's the same area. That's what I'm talking about.
Is that the same area that we just saw on the last exhibit with the red dots?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Generally speaking, I mean, there's no, it's such a wide open area, so when you pull up, you're not like pulling into the exact same spot each time to where you're creating a road or whatnot. It's just a nice grassy area. You pull up, go up to the back door, and you're right there at the back of the house.
And why do you go to the back of the house?
When my dad was alive, there's a little breakfast room there with a recliner in it. He was either in that recliner, at the table eating, in the bed, or not at home. I mean, that literally was his.
Right. So Doug, if you pull up Defendant's 135.
So everything's at the back of the house.
Right.
I mean, it's just, they don't use this. It's a large home, and they just don't. You know, as old as they are, well, my mom can't get out of bed, but as old as they are, they don't go to the front.
I'm sorry, just skip that. 131, Defendant's 131 in evidence, please. Again, is this sort of the same area photographed from a different direction?
Yes, sir.
Now, what's that structure that we see in the background past that big oak tree?
That was my dad's cookhouse, or man cave, as some people would call it. That's
okay.
Yeah.
And how far is that from the house, roughly?
You know, I would guess 60 to 80 yards.
Okay. And that's is it open around there? I mean, from the photo, is that accurate?
Oh, it's absolutely.
All right.
That whole area is a grassy area with oak trees and pecan trees.
So Marvin, I want to go to Labor Day weekend of 2021. Where were you that weekend? Do you remember?
Labor Day weekend 21.
When Alec went to the hospital?
Okay, yeah. Oh, yes, yes. So so I had been out west fishing, and I came in on Saturday night.
Okay. And did you, prior to Labor Day weekend 2021, were you aware as to whether or not Alec had an opioid addiction?
No, sir.
Did you transport Alec, drive Alec from the hospital in Savannah to a detox facility in Atlanta on that weekend, or?
Well, I believe it would have been on that Monday. I was not driving. Randy and I took him. Randy was driving and I was in the back. But yes, sir, we did take him to a detox facility.
And where was the facility located?
Just outside of Atlanta.
Okay. And what was, can you describe for the jury Alec's condition, like physical condition in the car?
Yes, sir. So when I met Randy over in Savannah, he had Alec, and I got in the car, or Randy's truck with him. I'd never seen anything like it. I've seen television shows of talking about the leg twitching and the squirminess, if you will, and that's the first thing. I mean, you could just tell he was sweating. He was thrashing about. You know, Jim. I don't know how much detail you want me to go into.
What, did he turn around in the seat of the car, and what was he doing?
Yeah, so maybe halfway there, at one point, he had taken his seatbelt off, and he had his head down where your fanny would be in the seat, and is trying to stretch his legs and just kind of steady, just like thrashing them and kicking them. It's just, again, I've seen TV, but I've never seen something like this in real life.
And was he able to control himself?
No, sir. I said about detail. So he messed himself. He had diarrhea. He just couldn't control it.
And then...
And I say diarrhea, I'm not talking about at a restroom. I'm talking about in the car, in his pants.
Okay. And after... he spent some time in the facility in Atlanta. Did you and your brother go pick him up and take him to another facility in Orlando, Florida?
Yes, sir, we did.
Do you remember that?
Yes, sir, I did.
On the drive to Orlando, do you remember anything happened that stands out to you?
You know, so that drive, he was much different. He was more subdued. It was not the thrashiness, not the twitching, not the jerkiness, if you will. I don't know the words that you would use for that, but that's what I'm saying. The only thing that really stood out for me is he slept a lot of the time, but he woke up from sleeping, and when he woke up, I mean, he jerked forward, and you could just tell that, I mean, it was sheer terror. He just woke up out of a horrible, horrible dream, and I believe it was him dreaming about what he found with Paul and Maggie.
Keep going a little further, Mr. Murdoch, and sometime in September, did SLED actually come and search the house at Alameda?
Yes, sir.
And were you present?
I was.
Okay, and you... And were you informed as to what items were seized during that search?
I was informed of one item that was seized.
And what item was that?
It was described as a coat.
What kind of coat?
Well, they didn't tell me what kind of coat.
Okay. And and did they tell you where the coat was found?
Yes, sir. So I would assume that the searching of the house, all that was winding down. So Agent David Owens and I I believe Randy was outside near us, but he may have been talking to somebody else. I'm not sure. May have been talking to another agent. I'm not sure. But David Owens, or Agent Owens, came up to me and said, we found a coat back on the property. Do you know anything about it? And I said, well, David, I said, if you found it back on the property, I said, my, you know, it's a large piece of property, you know, some 400 something acres. I said, my dad rides this Kubota side by side. It's probably his. And I said, and if you show it to me, I can try to identify it. And of course, he said he couldn't show it to him or wouldn't show it to me. I'm not sure what it was.
Were you sometime later asked to view a photo of a blue raincoat?
I was. Well, I was asked to view a raincoat and listen to an audio tape.
Of the kennel?
Yes, sir.
Okay. On the blue raincoat, were you informed where it was seized from?
Well, I knew where it was seized from because he had already told me. But I was, in this instance, I was told that they wanted us to, or when I say us, they asked Randy, Lynn, and I to go view the coat and the tape. At this point, I knew where it had been recovered, but they said, we want you to view a coat that had been recovered out of a closet.
And was that different from what you were led to believe when you?
Oh, absolutely.
Had you ever, did they ever provide, anybody provide an explanation about why you were giving two different locations where a coat was found?
To this day, no one's told me that.
The photo of the coat that they showed you, had you ever seen that raincoat before?
No, sir.
And was it the blue raincoat that?
Well, it certainly looked similar to the one. I saw a picture. I didn't see the coat itself. But it certainly looked to be similar or the same.
Had you ever seen it before?
No, sir.
Did you recognize what closet it came out of when from photos during this trial?
Well, I saw that, and I think I know what closet they're referring to.
Well,
there's only two, I'm sorry.
The closet as you go up on the first flight of stairs before you go at the landing right there, is what's kept there?
Clothing, not everyday clothing that's more or less in storage, junk.
Right. Okay.
You know, it's not a first of all, my dad wouldn't climb stairs even if he could, but he couldn't.
Right. The there's some testimony that there's GSR on that rain coat. Got any idea how there could be GSR on clothing in your dad's closet at Almeda?
Objection.
No idea.
Sustained.
Did your dad carry guns around with him?
No, not in the sense that you're saying. So he was not like Paul that always had guns with him. You know, he would keep a gun if he went dove hunting, for example, and he went on one dove hunt. That gun may ride with him for 2 months. He just would stay. He just would. Same with golf clubs. If he went back when he would play golf, he just.
During
a bunch of junk in his truck.
During hunting season, was there normally a gun in the back seat?
During hunting season, I would say that there usually would be.
And did he?
In fact, during hunting season, because he always loved to go on a bird hunt.
And did he have a specific gun that he used frequently?
Oh, he had one gun.
And was did that gun have a name?
It did. It was called Bo Whoop.
And did he clean it often?
I've never seen him clean it. He got that gun in 1957 for his high school graduation, and he used it for every game that he chased. But I'm sure it got cleaned somewhere along the way, but I'd never seen him clean it, and I still haven't seen him clean it.
Got it.
I don't know how the thing still worked.
Along the way, have you been receiving updates from SLED on their investigation in the Maggie and Paul's murder?
Usually when I call, I would call Agent Owens and ask for updates, and he would try to provide some updates. It almost always seemed like there was stuff that he really, I don't know whether he didn't know or just it wasn't at liberty to say at the time, I'm not sure. But yeah, he would try to give updates as best as possible.
And were you providing information on evidence that they had against your brother?
I have been, yes, sir.
Has
some of it.
Some of the information that you've been provided turned out not to be accurate information?
Yes, sir.
What type of information?
Well, I was told at one point that there was a T-shirt that he was wearing. And can I back up and tell you how we got into this conversation?
Sure.
So I'm having a meeting with SLED.
Yes, sir. Make sure they're drunk.
Calls for your sir.
Statement of an opponent, Your Honor. Agent of an opponent. It's a statement of a party opponent.
Party opponent.
Agent of the party opponent. It's
agent,
a SLED agent
of
yes,
the
sir.
Party opponent.
Yes, sir.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we have you take a break now. Please do not discuss the case. All right, everybody be seated. Hear this objection again.
State's objecting, calls for hearsay.
Right. And your response to the Mr.
Yes, Your Honor.
Just a moment, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Mr. Conrad's response to Mr. Griffin.
Your Honor, I think his argument was it's an admission by a party opponent. And I don't think we're talking about
party opponent. Party opponent.
Right. And the subsection 801D2, I think, is what we're referencing. And it talks about admission by a party opponent. It doesn't necessarily talk about the statement, and I think what we're getting into are some statements by particular law enforcement officers who've already been on the stand, and I don't think those are admissions to any issue that's of relevance in this case.
Mr. Griffin?
Your Honor, directly relevant. The statements relate to evidence that they've told the family they have against Mr. Murdoch.
Directly relevant?
Yes, sir.
Right, so the objection not based on relevance.
Well, I thought that's what. So a statement of a party opponent is non-hearsay under the definition of hearsay. Your Honor, I don't have the rule in front of me, but under
the state of South Carolina is a party opponent in this case.
And SLED is the investigative agency? Yes, sir. If otherwise, the rule would not apply in a criminal case. I mean, it has to be the investigative agency. I'm not asking for Collin County statements or it's the.
Well, you've gotten those in already, the newspaper statements, Collin County's call to the newspaper or whatever.
Yes, sir.
What else, Mr. Conrad?
I'd also object for the relevance as well, Your Honor, because the state has not offered the shirt and evidence, and the defense is attempting to kind of backdoor here, and it simply doesn't go to any issue, anything that's issued in this trial.
He's already testified to the shirt.
He's trying to get evidence, and maybe we need to proffer it to see exactly what he would say, but my assumption was that he was going to start talking about a report by Mr. Bevel, which we've talked about several times in this case, and I'd object to the relevance, and to particularly with Mr. Murdaugh bringing it up.
All right. Well, tell me again what you're asking the witness.
Proffer it
to the witness, yes.
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 So, Mr. Murdaugh, what information were you provided by, was it a sled agent that provided you the information?
Yes.
You were asking him about Agent Owens. Still, he's a sled agent, yes.
And what information were you provided that leading up to this that turns out to be inaccurate?
Right, and if it's okay for me to speak for you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So what I was asking, I was saying I wanted to back up to get to where I was getting this information. So I'd been called to SLED, not headquarters, but their office in Waldenburg to view the blue coat and to listen to an audio. After my interview with them, Captain Ryan Neal, I believe we were in his office, is the one that, and I'm going to use my terminology here, but describe the white T-shirt covered in blood, even went so far as to describe that Alec took the bottom of it and wiped his face with it, and that's how they knew he was involved. That's how they knew he was there. And I don't know where the question goes.
Can
after
I answer
that
your question, or are you trying to dig more out of him?
That's it.
All right, and what's your objection?
I renew my objection to the relevance. Nothing has been put, this jury hasn't heard any evidence about any blood being on this T-shirt, and the state has not offered any reports to suggest as such.
The objection is overruled. We're going to take 10 minutes.